chicas. Hello, family. Super excited to share my heart and preach the word tonight to y'all. Well, as Haley introduced us, we're going to go over the, you know, in Hebrews 5, Regina and I, and I'll be talking to those of the young Christians here. But I want to see, we haven't done this in a long time. Please stand up if you've been a disciple for maybe a little over a year or less. Please stand up, stand up, stand up, stand up. Woo! Awesome. Yeah, I see. I know Chino, Zephra. Hi, chicas. Aw. Well, you guys are considered the young Christians of the crowd here. That's right. Wait, since you've been a disciple for, but too long. It's okay. I love your heart. Well, buckle down because I got a little lesson for y'all. But although, yes, I'll be addressing the young Christians, it's still the Bible, so it applies to all of us. But this is the call for every Christian. Let us turn to 1 Peter chapter 2. 1 Peter chapter 2. Alrighty, 1 Peter chapter 2. And we're going to start in verse 2. But it says, like newborn babies, crave pure spiritual milk, so that by it you may grow up in your salvation, now that you have tasted that the Lord is good. I love that. I love the scripture. Because right here it talks about the moment when you said Jesus is Lord, the moment where you got baptized for the forgiveness of your sins. That is the moment where you became an infant in Christ. And you guys are brand new. But think of it, you know, think about yourself. You're just like a little baby. And how does a baby get the nutrients it needs? It needs milk. It needs all those nutrients so that it can be able to grow up. And so my end goal in this short 15-minute charge here is to help you crave the pure spiritual milk that Peter talks about here and to continue to nourish your soul. So with that being said, my title here is Crave Spiritual Milk. And my first point will be meditate on God's word. So turn with me to Joshua 1. Joshua 1, it's in the Old Testament. Of course, you know, for those who don't know, Joshua 1. Joshua 1, and for the sake of time, I'm going to start reading it. In verse 1, it says, keep this book of the law always on your lips. Meditate on it day and night so that you may be careful to do everything written in it. Then you'll be prosperous and successful. I love this scripture. Right here, God is giving this great charge to Joshua. Joshua was about to lead the Israelites into the Jordan River to the promised land. And he said before this great task, before Joshua goes on and conquers the land, before he rallies the people, before he rallies the priests and everything else, the first thing that God tells him to do is to, on his lip, to always meditate day and night. So what does this look like? What does it look like to meditate on God's word? It's quiet times. Quiet times, quiet times, quiet times. Yeah, guys, I won't stress this enough. Quiet times are so important. They're so vital. But here, meditating is not another word for reading. I say that again. Meditating is not another word for reading. I think a lot of us in our quiet times, we make the mistake to check off the box and read something. But are you meditating in the Word of God? The word meditating in Hebrews, I'm going to butcher this a bit, but it means haga, H-A-G-A-H, which literally translates to mutter, to mutter something. It means to continuously mutter God's word on your lip. And when you continuously mutter something, you're also thinking about that as well. But it means to soak in it. What does it mean to you? So I think for, this is so important because I think lately from what I've been seeing, a lot of the young Christians here, I've been seeing you very overwhelmed, very anxious. And some of my ambitious sisters, I've been seeing you make decisions, eager to make decisions, without getting guidance from the scriptures. I know a lot of you guys have some full days. I know you guys want to conquer your day, but this is really important. Our everyday lives and our everyday problems are not unique to the Bible. I think a lot of us would be like, oh, we may not say it out loud, but we think people don't understand or God understand. But ladies, our problems are not unique to the Word of God. And so find yourself in the Bible when you open your Bible the next morning. Because the Word has all the guidance and the wisdom you need. Find yourself there. I think one of the practicals here, you just need to create your scriptures that you can memorize, right? Is there any scriptures that you can memorize so that you can mutter throughout the whole day to conquer your day? You know, I had the absolute privilege to take care of Mickey and Monty while the Demetrius went to Brazil for a conference. And I learned so much about Monty. I believe Monty's six years old. And it comforted my heart so much. There was a time where we took out Mickey. He was actually playing a basketball game, and a fight broke out. And so Matt, Monty, because he witnessed it, Matt decided to create a lesson to it. And Matt said, okay, Monty, in this situation, you need to keep your head in all situations. And because he was telling him, like, this is very important. And then a couple days later, Brianna took Monty to his soccer game. And right after, Monty told Brianna, hey, Brianna, I learned this from Matt, that I need to keep my head in all situations. And that was encouraging because I was like, wow, like, we need to be like those kids and, you know, sponge up the Word of God and so that we can continuously think about God's Word throughout our day. But ladies, that is the first thing. You need to meditate in God's Word. The next point here is invest time in prayer. Turn with me to Hebrews 5. Hebrews 5. Okay. Hebrews 5, second point, invest time in prayer. In verse 7, it says, during the days of Jesus' life on earth, he offered up prayers and petitions with fervent cries and tears to the one who can save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverent submission. Wow. During the days of Jesus' life on earth, he said that he prayed. And it's so true. Throughout the 3 years, throughout the Gospels, when you read it, all you see is either Jesus preaching and or praying. And it's so funny, as I was reading throughout the Gospels, you don't really see an account where he's teaching his men how to preach. But there is an account in Luke 11 where he's teaching his men and his women and how to pray. Because he saw that that was the very thing they were going to need when he was gone. Right? Prayer is so powerful and is so essential along with your quiet times. We have to think and ask ourselves, man, how much time am I investing in prayer? I really want you to write that question down and think about it. Look throughout your day. How much time are you investing prayer with God? You give school your time. You give yourself your time, a little self-care. You give family and relationships your time. You give time for money and fun. But some of us, some of the young Christians, we can give our leftover time to God. It has to be the very thing that you do when you wake up in the morning, ladies. Invest your time in God. I think one of the young Christians' mistakes that I wish I could have done earlier was schedule my prayer times. And so I had to see, like, what are my priority throughout the week? I know, like, a great indicator if you're craving spiritual milk is when you can resist the temptation to press the snooze button on your alarm clock. Yeah, I don't have a baby just yet, but I know from all the it's not an announcement. You know, I thought about it. I was like, I'm not going to bring up that. You guys go so crazy for babies. Anyways, but but I heard from some stories how some, you know, the infants will wake up at 3, 4, 5 in the morning ready to drink milk. But we need to be able to do that. And so, ladies, please look over your schedule, okay? Ask yourself, what is my priorities? In my humble opinion, I may be wrong in this, but I don't really believe in a balanced schedule, but I do believe you can schedule your priorities. And so as a disciple, the very first priority that we should be scheduling in our week is, when are we going to pray to God? And then stick to it. And then if you need help to, you know, keep you accountable, ask a friend. Have a prayer buddy. It's not that hard. But that you could be able to be consistent in your prayer life. My third point here is live with compassion. Turn with me to Matthew 9. Let's go to Matthew 9. Matthew 9. And we're going to start in verse 35. This is one of my favorite scriptures. It's a scripture that I always go to. Verse 35, it says, Jesus went through all the towns and the village, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom, and healing every disease and sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them, because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore send out workers into his harvest field. Live with compassion. One of my favorite attributes about Jesus is his compassion. And the way how you see it throughout the scriptures, it's incredible. And when he looked at the crowd, he wasn't talking about the physical aspect. He was talking about their spiritual needs, that they were harassed and helpless. But when he saw them, did he decide to walk away and take a nap? No. He's like, you know what? Let me just take a break. Let me you know, do a little meal right now. Let me take a little snack. He didn't do that. He didn't move on and be like, wow, this is pretty bad. Obviously, like, Jesus didn't do that. What did he do? How did he respond to those who are harassed and helpless? It says that he was moved with compassion, and then he said, we need to go send out the workers, right? I think a lot of us, for the young Christians, I think we can make a mistake where, when it comes to sharing our faith, that we have to feel compassionate or feel loved or feel moved, but compassion is an action. Right? Compassion is an action. When you realize, man, that people need Jesus, then we gotta go and share our faith. I think, you know, just to reference in Matthew 28, this is so important, where Jesus said to go and make disciples of all nations. Guys, God didn't just do that because for fun, you know, because he can make up this rules and be like, yeah, go, you need, this is your purpose. No. Guys, sharing our faith is what helps us keep us faithful. Whenever you're in a Bible study and you hear someone's story and where they come from, you're like, it humbles you. You're like, wow, you remember how much you needed God at that time as well. It's the very thing that keeps your heart softened. We need to continuously live with compassion and share our faith. I get it, guys. For me, sometimes I get very intimidated when, still to this day, to share my faith. But I think one of the things that helps me a lot is find my fishing pole, right? We all have that one place where we like to go. Whether it's our work area, school, that one cafe, that one mall, that one whatever area. There's so many incredible places in LA that we like to go. And there's this one cafe that I love going every time in the neighborhood. And I make it an effort to go there and make my presence and share my faith. And I think that for you guys, you got to go and pick somewhere where you can go and just share your faith. And practice compassion just like Jesus. It's what's going to keep your heart softened. It's what's going to keep you stay close to God. You must go and share your faith. But lastly, my last point here is keep growing in faith. So turn with me to 1 Peter chapter 2. 1 Peter chapter 2. My last point here, keep growing in faith. Keep growing in faith. So what is something that can hinder our cravings for spiritual milk? Well, 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 1, it says, therefore, rid yourself of all malice and all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and slander, and every kind. So, right, Peter mentions this before, craving spiritual milk. He's like, you got to first get rid of that, and then you can experience God's spiritual milk. There's also another scripture I'd like to show, just one more. Let's turn to 1 Corinthians 3. 1 Corinthians 3, because it's not the first time this was mentioned. Sometimes you just need a little bit more scriptures to convince you. So let me just show you one more. 1 Corinthians 3. In verse 1, it says, brothers and sisters, I could not address you as people who live by the Spirit, but as people who are still worldly, mere infants in Christ. I gave you milk, not solid food, for you were not ready for it. Indeed, you are still not ready. You are still worldly. Woo! This was a good one. This one right in the heart. But the one thing that could really hinder your walk with God to really experience what it means to crave spiritual milk, it's sin. This is so, so important to understand. I think some of us, what can stop us from craving pure spiritual milk is that sometimes we can replace our craving for the word with a craving of worldliness. This is important. You have to understand this. I think a lot of us, when you get baptized, just to mention this, you're coming out of slavery. In the book of Romans, it says you're either be a slave to righteousness or a slave to your sin. And so when you're coming to the kingdom, it's like you're going through rehab. It happens. But you have to learn how to treat that and medicate that with God's word. You know, it's so incredible. I actually found out a little fun fact. I see all the babies here too, so I thought might as well share it. But I love how I had no idea that if the infant is sick and is drinking from breast milk, it actually creates the products to heal the baby. That is so cool. That's amazing. I don't know. I'm blown away by that. But it's amazing that those who are our infants in the room, this is the very thing that's going to medicate your sin. So you need to be in there. The reason why I'm preaching these things is because these are the very things I actually personally didn't choose to do in my early walk with God. I'm about to hit 7 years as a disciple, but praise God. By the grace of God. But man, I can share more. I don't have all the time, but I can share my story later. Or you can ask me. But my first year was rough. When I hit my birthday, I was actually contemplating and making a decision whether I should walk away from God. Because I wasn't doing the simple things, the foundational teachings. I wasn't in my word. I wasn't having quiet times and prayer times. I wasn't going to the meetings of the body. I wasn't getting open. I was doing none of these things. And I just, from a sister to you guys, because I love you guys, I'm just pleading with you guys. Make sure that you're making a habit in these things. It's what's going to help. It's very simple. I think as sisters, we can sometimes make things very complex, but it's very, very simple. Stick to God and in the word of God. But just to close out, after this, we're actually going to be able, we're going to have D groups. And so if there's anything in your heart that you think that may be hindering you, please get up in the D group. Get the help that you need. Let's look back at 1 Peter 1. We're right here in verse 23. 1 Peter 1, and we'll close out here. 1 Peter 1, chapter 1, verse 23. It says, for you have been born again, not of perishable seed, but imperishable, through the living and enduring word of God. So right here, what Peter is saying is that through God's word, we've been born again. God's word is what gave birth to you. It's what gave you life. It's what gave you the Holy Spirit. It's what gave you to what spurs you on. So if the very words is what gave birth to you, it's the very thing that's going to sustain you. This is all we need, ladies. And so just to close out, if you take the M from meditate on God's word, if you take the I to invest time in prayer, the L, live with compassion, and the K in from keep growing in faith, it spells milk. So crave it. Crave the spiritual milk. I love you guys. Let's give it up one more time for Salma. And I get the honor of preaching on to maturity. I was looking up some quotes about spiritual maturity, and I want to share with you some of my findings. One, spiritual maturity is realizing that the biggest battle isn't against the devil, but against hitting the next episode button on Netflix. It said, you're not spiritually mature until you can resist the urge to check your phone during a sermon, especially when it vibrates from a notification from Instagram or TikTok. It says, the only time some people exercise their spiritual muscles is when they're jumping to conclusions. That one hit me in my chest. I felt that one. But this one was my favorite. Spiritual maturity is not measured by how high you jump in worship, but by how straight you walk in obedience. My name is Regina Ridola, and I am so grateful to be preaching alongside one of my best friends, Salma. And the topic that I have today is on to maturity. And the title of my lesson is Blessed to Level Up. Blessed to Level Up. And it's a blessing because growing old is mandatory, but maturing is optional. It's completely optional. The Bible defines maturity as growing to resemble Christ in your faith, your character, and your understanding. Growing to resemble Christ in your faith, character, and understanding. And it is marked by fruitfulness, by resilience, by humility, by wisdom, and a growing reliance on God. In the Greek text, in Hebrews 5:14, where it talks about maturity, it comes from the root teleos, which means completeness, fullness, and maturity. And that can only come from relying on God. And I love the scripture in 1 Corinthians 13, verse 11. You can write that down, because Paul talks about what is the opposite of maturity, which is immaturity. And he says, when I was a child, I talked like a child, I thought like a child, I reasoned like a child. But when I became a man, I put childhood behind me. And so we see here he's talking about the spiritual immaturity in the Corinthian church, but he's talking about embracing the maturity that comes with it. And so what is immaturity? I'm glad you asked. Immaturity is defined by a lack of growth in faith and in your relationship with God. And so it's being easily swayed by false teachings. Ephesians 4:14 talks about that, just being tossed by the waves. It's only wanting milk, you know, not wanting the hard things like Salma talked about, you know. In 1 Corinthians 3, verse 1 to 3, it says it's gossip, it's slander, and it's being divisive. That's immature. It says unforgiveness is immature, quiet reservations are immature, and selfishness. Being unwilling to serve and give your time. The Bible is that double-edged sword, you know. It's going to build you up, you know, but it's also going to expose where we are. And honestly, I've been on both sides
of immaturity and maturity. And I'm so grateful because I really do believe that God has put a lesson on my heart to share with you all tonight. And so without further ado, let's turn to Philippians 3, verse 12. Philippians 3, verse 12. And while you guys are flipping there, Philippians 4, 19 says, "And my God will meet all your needs according to the riches of his glory in Christ Jesus." And I love that this is a promise of God. Like, God will complete us. God will mature us. He will give us everything we need if we tap into relying on him fully. And so point number one, level up in relying on God. Level up in relying on God. And so Philippians 3, verse 12. Are you guys there? Caught up with me? Okay. The Bible reads, "Not that I have already obtained all this or have already arrived at my goal, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it, but one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining towards what is ahead, I press toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus." Wow. And I love what Paul says here. Paul is writing to the Philippian church from prison, right? He reflects on his spiritual journey, acknowledging that he has not yet arrived. He hasn't made it, you know, and I for sure have not made it. Has anyone? Okay, we're all growing. We're all learning. And so this scripture is us. And I just appreciate it because you see his humility. Despite his achievements, despite his religious pedigree, he's just like, I am still learning. I'm still striving to grow closer to God. And you see this upward call as he desires to get closer to God. And I know that that constant striving will continue to be a part of us as we mature. But what helps us to mature? Trials. In James 1, verse 2 to 3, the Bible says, "Consider it pure joy, my sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. Let perseverance finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything." There is nothing that reveals in my life and probably all of our lives the areas where we don't rely on God or the areas that we're not mature than a trial or a conflict, you know. I'd be so spiritual in my prayer. And then the first comment outside my prayer, I have to go back and pray sometimes, you know. And so it's amazing because God allows these things to come so that he can refine us. He wants to make us and present us pure as gold so that we can be refined on our way to heaven. But I love when you keep reading this scripture because it says, "If any of you lack wisdom, you should ask God who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to you." And I remember there was a D time that I had with Sarah Dimitri, and she shared this insight about this scripture that I'd never seen before. And she says that when you pray and you ask God for wisdom, he's not looking to see whether you deserve it or not. It says he gives it to you without finding fault. God longs to give you wisdom. He longs to give you maturity. And all you have to do is ask. It's that simple. And so I'm really grateful because I'm sure many of us are going through some trials right now, right? Maybe it's the trial of maturing and having a godly attitude through any and every situation. Maybe it's the trial of building new relationships, right? It's a lot of change in your life, different people, different discipler maybe. Maybe it's anticipating change. I know there's some transitions coming up. You know, some of us will be moving. Maybe that can create some trials in our lives. Maybe it's just raising people up. It's harder than it looks sometimes, you know. Maybe you've been hurt and you need to forgive again. And so it's one thing if you've been hurt, but it's being hurt again and having to forgive again. Maybe it's tough things in our marriages, with our kids. Maybe it's your health. You've been sick quite a bit, and it's been hard to really bounce back and to do the things that you used to do. Maybe there's a lot on your plate and you just feel stretched, right? And it's hard to trust God's plan in these moments. Maybe it's a financial hit, or you're seeing someone that you love going through a tough time financially, right? The Bible teaches us that these trials are not purposeless, but that God is producing something. He's producing perseverance so that we may be mature and complete. He's not just letting us go through it. He's not doing it to us, but he's going through it with us, you know, and being able to have that perspective. But how can we take it to the next level of relying on God? My one and only practical for this point is prayer and fasting. Prayer and fasting. Sometimes we get to this wall where we see ourselves and we might feel stuck, like, man, I feel like I'm not growing or I'm not getting it. What is the lesson that God is trying to teach me? Well, Jesus says in Mark 9, verses 14 through 29, that some things can only be revealed through prayer and fasting. There is a spiritual breakthrough that God wants to teach you, but it may not come until you pray and fast. And fasting is not just not eating, you know, that's dieting or starving, you know, that's not what we want. But it's specifically restraining from food for a spiritual purpose. It's putting yourself in a state where you're hungering and thirsting for righteousness. It's we eliminate food so our spirit is uncluttered and undistracted so that we're sensitive to what God is saying and what God is showing us to do. And it produces spiritual discipline. And that's point number two. Level up in discipleship. Point number two, level up in discipleship. Please turn with me to Amos 3, verse 3. You guys already know that one, huh? Amos 3, verse 3. The Bible says, are we still turning? Okay. Level up in discipleship. The Bible says in Amos 3, verse 3, do two walk together unless they have agreed to do so? And I love this scripture because at the start of every discipling relationship, I like to read this scripture because I never assume that someone wants to walk with me just because I'm in their life, you know? And what discipleship is, it's the ability to have a relationship with Christ, but then to have a spiritual mentor in your life who will help you to see the specks or sometimes the planks in your eye so that you can continue to grow and mature in Christ. And I don't know what I would do without the women in my life who so lovingly, kindly, and consistently help me to see the areas that I need to grow in. And this scripture says that that can't happen unless there's an agreement on both sides. We need people to teach us to obey everything. We need people to encourage us, to pray with us, to see our blind spots. And with maturity, maturity allows discipling. It's immature to not be discipled. And that's super convicting for me. Because I used to think I know it all, and I don't know it all. And the more you know, the more you see you really didn't know. You know what I mean? And so we see why Paul probably said that. Like, I'm still striving to grow because he probably saw more things as he matured in his faith where he was just like, whoa, I thought I was close last year. I had no idea what this year was going to show me. And so what does it look like to mature, right, in our discipleship? It's not consistently canceling D times. It's coming ready to get advice, ready to get open about sin. And it's not being defensive when you're asked questions as your discipler seeks to understand so that they can properly diagnose. We're like little nurses. God is the doctor. We're getting instructions from God as the nurses. We got to ask some questions to figure out, you know, what's going on. And so even for the disciplers, though, part of maturing in discipleship and in discipling, it's praying for your women. praying for their strength, praying to have the heart of Manoah. In Judges 13, verse 8, I read this from my quiet time yesterday. I'm reading through the Bible in a year. And in Judges 13, verse 8, it's after Samson's parents, you know, they get this dream from God. The angel of the Lord comes and speaks to them and tells them, you're going to conceive a child. And the wife tells, you know, Manoah. And the first thing Manoah prays is he says, I beg you, teach us how to bring up the child you're giving us. Wow. He's like, teach us what to do. And there's a humility, like, this is your child, this is your son, your daughter. How do you want me to teach them? How do you want me to coach them? What do you want me to tell them? How should I pray for them? And there's a humility when it comes to the women that God has placed in our lives as well. In our D times, we should be teaching them what we're learning. You know, most of my lessons, most of my D times are literally what I'm learning in my D times with Sarah. I'm so grateful for Sarah. She pours herself out and she pours herself into all of us. But I've been so edified through God's word as she's ministered to me. And I go out and I teach that. I do not pretend that I'm perfect, because then you're gonna see my flaws and hold me like extra accountable. I'm like, no, I'm a hot mess, guys, but I'm growing, you know? And so even for us, we shouldn't be intimidated by the women in our lives that they're better than us or that they have different strengths than our weaknesses. We need to learn from them, you know? And it's making their dreams your dreams. The goals that they have, we should be helping them to strive towards them. And we can't give up on them. One thing that I love about God is that his mercy renews every morning. And so our mercy has to renew every morning. Our forgiveness has to renew every morning. Like, God sees us with a clean slate. And so we have to see our women through those eyes as well as we continue to raise them up. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. And so two challenges, two practicals from this one. Number one, prioritize and guard your D times. And your D times are your mentorship times, your discipling times with your spiritual mentor. Allow them to disciple you. Take the correction. Seek to understand. Pray over it. And allow God to really reveal to you the things that he has on his heart as he's helping you to grow in this season. But then the second practical that I have is just a D time for everyone, you know. One of the biggest needs that I see right now in the church is for leaders to step up and serve. There are so many areas for serving, but there are so many talented women in this room. It's like amazing, you know, like there's just, it's just amazing how much talent is in this room. And so look for opportunities to serve where you can bless others. And so one area that we need people to serve is in Kids Kingdom, you know. We need, and I'm really grateful for Donna and Jem Fenton for taking on coordinating Kids Kingdom. And I'm also grateful for Esther Hernandez. She, like, did so much for Kids Kingdom, oh my goodness, the past several months. And so right now we need someone to help step up and to help teach the kids in our children's ministry. I'm looking for one teacher. I feel like someone's going to talk to me tonight and volunteer. I have that kind of faith, and so find me, please. We need you to serve. We need people to serve with our teen ministry. You know, the teens are so awesome. Where are the teens? Let's give it up for the teens. They are so awesome. I don't even know if I can fully comprehend just what they have on their plates, like a full-time school load, still having to be under their parents' roof and to obey and to clean their rooms and to do all of that extracurriculars. The temptation that happens in high school and the things that they get exposed to, but we have teens who are fighting for their purity, for righteousness, and it's just so amazing because Hannah was baptized on Saturday at Women's Day. And she's a teen, and it was just so awesome because I know Jada and Trini and all the other teens, they poured into her during that time. And so we need to continue to pray for the teens ministry and help strengthen the teens ministry. But also for our marrieds ministry. Any marrieds here? I love the marrieds. And so even for the marrieds, we need more marrieds events. right? I'm really grateful for Deshay. Where's Deshay? Where's she at? So I really appreciate Deshay because Deshay's constantly planning things, and not just for the married. Even last year, she planned a mommy-daughter, like, tea party just to bring unity and family in the region. And so if you're thinking of ideas and you want to serve, like, Selma, we're not going to say no. You know, we welcome it. We enjoy it. It's going to be opportunities for us to invite more friends out so that they can be able to see what it looks like to have spiritual marriages and spiritual families. This is really the hope for the world, right? But we need to step up and to serve in those ways. I'll bring up the singles. Where are my singles at? I just really appreciate the singles. One thing that I love about the singles is just how they share everywhere they go. Everywhere. There's no one place for the singles ministry. The world is the singles ministry. And I just appreciate that. But having more events where the whole singles ministry comes together, even just things super regionally, where on a Friday night, you know, where we go out, we fellowship, and we can reach out to the people around us. Another way we can serve is just by being more giving in the fellowship. You know, I was really grateful because today there were so many people who came at 7:30 and it was just like a buzz of electric, like, fellowship that was happening, you know. And so coming to Midweek early so that we can talk to each other, see how our weeks were, you know, to really connect in that way. But it's also our zeal. And I'm so grateful for tonight because everyone's been like, yeah, come on, preach it. And I'm so grateful for that because that is serving. It's so hard to preach to a quiet audience, guys. You guys have been a joy. And so continuing to bring that energy, and not just tonight at Midweek, but it's at Devo, it's at church. I want to invite you guys too, especially as you're looking for opportunities to serve, to come Sunday afternoons to the leaders' meetings. During the leaders' meetings, we give practical training on what it looks like to raise up and become leaders. But then it's a great opportunity to see what some of the needs are and to be able to meet those needs, right? And just to close out, God wants us to mature. He wants to take us to the next level. And it's going to look like leveling up in relying on Him and leveling up in our discipleship. Thank you so much.